Not least when times are insecure, some segments of the church have indulged in a feeding frenzy of speculation about the last days. This has happened again and again. Some of it is informed and some of it is not. In North America, over the last 15 or 20 years, there has been the publication of a series called Left Behind. Whatever you think of the accuracy or otherwise of that series, it has certainly sold very well. So well, in fact, that one of my colleagues at Trinity, where I teach, with his typical sense of humor, tongue firmly pressed into his cheek, says that he wants to write a competing series. Perhaps he'll call it Right Behind. Sometimes these speculative endeavors completely miss the mark. And then sometimes in reaction, Christians refuse to think about the end at all. They see some silliness that is promulgated as being about the last days, and then they respond in turn by saying absolutely nothing about the last days so they don't look like idiots. Of course, the Bible does say some things about the last times, about the end. And it does no service to the church if preachers ignore what the Bible does say in a vain effort to tame the feeding frenzy. But what is perhaps most striking about the Bible's treatment of these matters is that by last days and last hour and last times, most frequently the biblical authors are referring to the entire period between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. For example, when the Apostle John writes his first letter, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, he says, "My dear children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so already there are many Antichrists, by which we know it is the last hour." In other words, he envisages that the last hour is a period of conflict between Christ and Antichrist. And insofar as there are already Antichrists, even before any ultimate Antichrist, therefore it must already be the last hour. So also here in the passage before us, chapter 3, verse 1, mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. So what is Paul doing? Is he saying, there will be terrible times in the last days, so let me tell you of something that's just got no immediate bearing on your life, but down the road it will happen, whether in a century, 2 centuries, a millennium, 2 millennia, it doesn't really matter. This is merely for your information. No, you can read the chapter yourself and see that Paul is talking about problems that they are facing already, and then he gives instructions about how to confront them. So this is an apostolic analysis of the entire period between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. All of this presupposes, of course, that there is ongoing, massive conflict. Conflict between Christ and Antichrist, between Jesus and Satan. This has been configured in quite a lot of different ways. One of the most helpful models of trying to understand this language was developed by a Swiss theologian called Oskar Kuhlmann after World War II. Those of you who remember your history books on World War II, you'll recall that in the European theater, after Stalingrad, the Russians were pressing in on the Nazis from the east. And the Western Allies had cleaned out North Africa, and then they had begun the slow march up the boot of Italy. But then in 1944, in 3 bloody days, they landed on the beaches of Normandy with 1.1 million troops and tons of materiel. And anybody with half a brain in his head could see that in the European theater, the war was, in principle, over. In terms of pressure from both fronts and coming up from the boot in terms of finances, in terms of energy and oil, in terms of production of steel, in terms of the number of troops and so on, the war was over. So what did Hitler do? Did he say, oops, and then sue for peace? No, some of the bloodiest fighting of the war took place after that. The Battle of the Bulge took place, for example, in which the Nazis almost got to the coast of France again, except they ran out of petrol. And the fight for Berlin was just about as bloody as the fight for Stalingrad. So likewise, in Revelation 12, when Satan is presented as enraged with the church of Jesus Christ today, enraged, he is enraged not because he's so powerful, but because he's been defeated in principle. He's been cast out of heaven. He knows that his time is short. He doesn't have access to God. He is a condemned and rather pathetic, if really horrible, creation. And because he's enraged, he vents all of his anger against the church. In other words, once the devil himself has witnessed the cross and resurrection of Jesus, does he say, "Oops, I goofed. Sorry." No, like Hitler, he says, "I will fight and I will destroy you to the very bitter end." So the church, therefore, is caught between D-Day, the day in which the troops landed on Normandy, and VE Day, Victory in Europe Day. That is, we are caught between the already and the not yet, between what Christ has already done. The victory has been secured in principle. Death has been overcome. There will be a resurrection. We know who's going to win. God's victory is secure. Forgiveness of sin has been won. The debt and the culpability has been paid. God's justice is satisfied. Human beings are forgiven and redeemed. The Spirit is poured out as the down payment of the promised inheritance. But, meanwhile, the devil goes about sometimes as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour, and sometimes as an angel of light deceiving, if it were possible, the very elect. Configured, in fact, in two beasts that show up in Revelation 13, a false prophet to deceive people and an antichrist figure to persecute them. And that is going to go on until Christ returns. We live in the last days. And the question is, how should Christians discharge their ministry, their Christian living, in the last days? There will be terrible times in the last days, our text says. The word used is often translated violent. There will be violent times in the last days. The same word used to depict the Gadarene swine. Out of control. Wild. So what will be the characteristics of the last days that warrant such a label as this? They're laid out for us in verses 2 to 5. There are 18 items, 19 traits, a sort of catalog of vices. The first four depict selfishness. Lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud. Lovers of money because money itself can so easily become a kind of god that ensnares us and enslaves us, ties us to this material order. It's not that the money itself is wicked, but once you love money, once greed entraps you, that becomes a chain that becomes for you an idolatrous, controlling, disabling, dehumanizing, satanic attack. Lovers of self as opposed to lovers of God. The first commandment is to love God with heart and soul and mind and strength. The second commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. Instead, I love me. Then there are two terms that suggest socially destructive behavior. Abusive, whether in word or in deed. It includes things like sexual abuse, but the language is more comprehensive than that. We can abuse people by our words, by our thoughts, by our relationships. Disobedient to their parents. That is, so rebellious at heart that even the most fundamental relationship of courtesy and socialization is overthrown. Then there are four unwords That is where you put in a prefix to show that what is operating is the opposite. Ungrateful, the opposite of being filled with gratitude. Unholy, unloving, unforgiving. Because so often sin is the absence of the good. Then there are two more that reflect speech and behavior. Slanderous, very quick to talk badly about people and say untrue things or slanted things or mean things regularly behind their backs. Without self-control, that is without level-headedness or the like, easy to fly off the handle. And then there are two more un-terms in the original. Our versions have something like brutal, but the word means literally untamed. That is savage, a word that serves equally to describe, let's say, fierce lions and people who act like them. Not lovers of the good, literally unloving of the good. Once again, it's the absence of something that is so sad. Instead of loving what is good, people love what is merely temporarily pleasurable or what promotes their interests or what pushes them forward, even if it pushes others down. They have no interest in pursuing what is transparently good in society or culture or anything else unless it suits their particular interests. It might be jolly good for a certain policy to take place for most people, but if it doesn't serve me, then I'm likely to vote against it, won't I? Four items then which might show that Paul is moving from characteristics of the age to the false teachers themselves. These people, he says, are treacherous, they're traitors, rash, little thought given to long-term consequences of the positions they take, conceited, far too impressed with their own opinions, egos the size of small planets, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. You see, traitors are always the most dangerous people in the church as elsewhere. If you have someone who from the beginning is opposed to Christianity, opposed to the gospel, opposed to who Jesus is, and eager to tear him down, either because they're coming out of another religious camp, let's say they're devout Muslims, or because they come out of the camp of philosophical naturalism, they don't want to have anything to do with supernaturalism, whatever the reason, and they oppose Christianity from the beginning, those people are not really all that dangerous. There will always be debate and there will be responders and so on, but people aren't usually snookered by them. But if you have a Christian teacher who has built a certain kind of reputation for integrity, for an ability to expound the word, and then begins to move a little bit away and a little bit farther away and then a little bit farther away again, eventually some Christian leader will say, "Oh, is that really quite right what you're saying? Does that really square with Scripture?" And others will instantly say, "Oh, don't be so picky, don't be so picky. You're just arguing about words. Oh, sorry, sorry." Then he moves a little farther away and then a little farther away. And somebody says, wait a minute. That really isn't what the apostle says about justification. It sounds good, but you really are switching categories. This is not what Holy Scripture says. And somebody else comes back and says, "Yes, we must have unity in the church. This person has said a lot of true things in the past, you see." And gradually the gospel is left behind. And the entire church can be split over someone who has been faithful and now becomes a traitor. That's what the word means. Treacherous with respect to the truth. Far too impressed by their own opinions, rash, conceited, and ultimately, at the end of the day, doing huge damage in the church. And finally, we're told, having a form of godliness, but denying its power. That is, there is a form of Christianity that likes, on the one hand, either liturgy and pomp and splendor, a form in that sense, or a form in terms of exhibition, emotional display, lots of cheerleading, as it were. A certain asceticism on the one hand, or a certain claimed knowledge, or a certain enthusiasm on the other, that becomes the mark of what religion means for them. But there is no power. Power in the sense that it is life-transforming, life-reorienting. It changes our time, our perspective, our sense of humor, our speech, our priorities, our loves, our passions, our goals, our fundamental purposes in living. Denying that kind of power, the whole world becomes a kind of religious Vanity Fair. In fact, the opponents in Paul's day were saying that true godliness is attested by their knowledge, not by the transformed behavior that Paul insists must be theirs. So Paul ends up this paragraph by saying, "Have nothing to do with such people." Now, this is an important principle, but you have to be careful with it. For it is sadly true that one or more of these 19 traits show up often enough amongst God's own people and have to be dealt with. If we cite, "have nothing to do with them," and apply it to anyone who is ever guilty of any of these sins, realistically, we'd have to begin by excommunicating everybody, starting with ourselves. And yet the point is still important. Where there is a pattern of these things, there you're spotting what is characteristic of the last days. The same John who talks about the last days in 1 John 2 says a little farther on in 1 John 4, "My dear children, don't be deceived. Whoever does righteousness is righteous." In the ancient world, it was quite common to put religion and ethics in separate categories, so that you could be ever so spiritual, ever so religious, ever so spiritual, but how you lived wasn't thereby transformed. But biblical religion has never been satisfied with that. It is constantly said that one of the evidences that you really do find yourself under this covenant with God, whether the old covenant or the new covenant sealed with Jesus' own blood, is the fact that life really does change. There really is transformation of character, of conduct, of speech. And at some point or other, the church has got to say, if you're acting like an unregenerate person, characteristically, then the only inference we may draw is that you are unregenerate. That is why there is church discipline in the Bible. The ultimate church discipline, that is excommunication, which somebody is actually removed from the church in the New Testament, is bound up with only three things. Number one, major doctrinal defection, especially in teachers. Number two, major moral defection, a life that is so out of line with elementary scripture ethics and morality that it is denying Christ. One thinks, for example, of the man who insists on sleeping with his stepmother in 1 Corinthians 5 and will not repent. Or third, complete and utter schismatic lovelessness. Warn a divisive person once and then twice and then have nothing more to do with them. Because the tests in behavior for genuine Christianity turn out to be a truth test. You hold to the gospel. There is a social test. You love brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. And there is a moral test. You bow under Jesus' lordship and delight to do His word and way. It's not that those things earn you salvation. But where salvation takes hold in a person's life, there is increasing conformity to these tests. I have a friend, retired now from the ministry. He's a bit of an old man now, but he was always very astute in his dealing with students. And I recall 15 years or so ago when he watched one of our graduates who was intellectually very gifted. Charm, it just dripped from him. And a certain kind of facility with words, an able communicator. But when he got into a church, he turned out to be astonishingly abusive, controlling, ultimately wicked, handled people horribly. It became more and more wretched. His own family was bearing more and more abuse. People came alongside, tried to help him, tried to reconstruct him, to hold him accountable. And he just became harder and harder. And finally, my friend went to him and said, "Rick, are you converted?" "Oh, come on. You know, I've been a Christian for a long time. I mean, I remember the day of my conversion. And I know what conversion is. I can answer your theological questions. I'm a good and able teacher of the Word of God. I don't teach heresy." "Rick, are you converted?" Why are you picking me on me this way? I could point to people that I've led to Christ myself. Rick, are you converted?
And then in his final paragraph describing these false teachers, verses 6 to 9, Paul establishes two or three further points. Number one, they prey on the vulnerable. Not infrequently with sexual connotations. They are the kind who worm their way into homes and gain control over gullible women who are loaded down with sins and are swayed by all kinds of evil desires, always learning but never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. The language suggests a certain kind of sneaky infiltration. I have had to deal with enough instances over the years of ministers of the gospel who have had to leave their posts because of illicit sexual liaisons, that I've come to observe a few patterns. Almost never is it a matter merely of sex. Oh, sex is involved, but it's rarely merely sex. There's usually some desire to control, to be reinforced in their power. They're feeling a bit insecure, and this is the way they take it out. And not infrequently, on the other side, there is a desire to be connected with the leader, to be connected with someone who is perceived to be powerful or at the front or the like. The text is not saying that all women are gullible and foolish. It is saying that there is a confluence of evils. On the one side, power, control, manipulation. On the other, weak-willed women with their own baggage of sins and neuroses. And when the two come together, there is a horrible clash, hugely destructive. This is no more saying that all women are like this than it is saying that all men are like this. But it is saying that when the two come together, the false teaching and the false morality so often bring about a terrific display of catastrophic destruction. They have depraved minds and are careless about the truth, we're told in verse 8. But sooner or later, their folly becomes evident to everyone. It takes a while sometimes to work out who these false teachers are, but sooner or later it comes out, verse 9. Well, this is a really cheerful way to begin the third evening, isn't it? Indeed, some commentators writing on this passage say that Paul is really going a bit over the top. It's a bit of a caricature. This really isn't what the world is like. There are lots of good things going on in the world, aren't there? Lots of nice people out there, lots of non-Christians who are very helpful. And after all, there are wonderful organizations like Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, grounded in France. And after all, the Bible speaks of a certain kind of common grace in which many people show kindness, even though they're pagans or the like. Isn't Paul just a bit over the top? Enough negativism here. But I don't think Paul would deny the reality of common grace. Elsewhere, without using the term, he talks about the way God in his mercy restrains evil, even in this wicked world. We're not as bad as we could be. We could always be worse. But when Paul paints with this broad brush, he is not saying that every false teacher is characterized equally by all of these things. He is describing these people of the last days in typical categories. And this is what you find. Moreover, so many of these categories are viewed not from the sort of relativistic light of who's socially nice or who's not socially nice, but from God's absolute category. Where does righteousness stand then when you make God himself the standard? What does greed look like over against God? What does love look like when you measure it against the love he has shown in the cross? What does truth look like? What does humility look like when you compare yourself not with what is socially acceptable in our society, but when you compare it to God himself? And you know what? even in the best and nicest of homes, you don't have to delve very far into the homes. Once you get into them and get to know them well, you discover again and again and again that there are all kinds of elements of brokenness and distrust and arrogance and one-upmanship in the best of homes. This is not an unrealistic picture. And the question is, how should Christians live in the light of it? What counsel does Paul give Timothy in the light of these realities? How do you live in the last days? Four things. Number one, hold the right mentors in high regard. Hold the right mentors in high regard. Verse 10, you, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, sufferings. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. Hold the right mentors in high regard. Do you see, Paul is introducing himself as an alternative model. This is what is going on in this world of the last days. But you, however, you follow me. Tell me, do you ever say to a young Christian, just a little younger than yourself, your fourth year, to somebody who's just converted in first year, or in a few years you'll be 35 and married, a kid, and you're talking to a graduate student who's 23, 24, do you ever say, do you want to know more about the Christian life? Watch me. But you should be saying that. Elsewhere, the apostle says, be imitators of me, even as I also am of Christ. When I was an undergraduate reading chemistry and mathematics at McGill many moons ago, in my third year, working with IVCF in Canada, InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, I really thought that I should try and start a men's Bible study in my dorm. There were very few Christians. There was another chap called Dennis Dash and myself, and he was much more restrained and shy. But between the two of us, we didn't know very much. We just thought that we should start an evangelistic Bible study. So we decided to study the book of John, and we didn't want to be outnumbered too badly, so we only invited three people. Hoped that not more than two would come. All three came, and then the numbers began to grow, and by week five, we had 16 people coming to this Bible study, and I was way out of my depth. Didn't have a clue what I was doing. I was doing my best, but I was facing all kinds of questions that I didn't know how to handle at all. But there was on campus a chap called Dave Ward. Dave was a rough jewel. He was converted from a horrible background, but he was genuinely converted and was bold as brass in his own evangelism and talking to people. At this point, he was a graduate student, and sometimes he would let some of us younger guys go to him with people in our groups that were asking questions that we didn't know how to handle at all. So I brought two of my guys down one night to go and see Dave Ward, and we got in, and he was slapping things around. There was no finesse to the man. He really was a rough jewel. Slap down some coffee. Here, want some? Have some coffee. You like milk? Slosh, slosh. I mean, this was not an elegant situation. And we barely got in there, and he turned to the first one and said, okay, why did you come? Dave's strong point was not chit-chat. And the first one said, well, you know, I think that university is a great time to study different religions and stuff. You know, I don't have any sort of religious background myself, but I'd like to learn a bit more about Islam and a bit more about Buddhism and a bit more about Confucianism. And then this Bible study started, so I thought it might be time to learn a bit about Christianity. So I thought I'd come along, and I suppose that's why I'm here. I'd like to know a bit more. Dave looked at him. And then he said, sorry, I don't have time. And I thought, what have I done? And the student looked at him and said, I beg your pardon? He said, I don't have time. He said, listen, if you want to know more about Christianity compared with other religions, I can recommend some books and so on. But look, I'm a student myself. I don't have time just to chew the fat. If you're a dilettante that's just beginning to explore things, I'll give you some stuff to read, but I don't have time just to chat, 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 chat. What did you come for? And he turned to the second one. The second one said, listen, I come from a home that I think you guys would call theological liberals. You know, we don't believe in literal resurrection from the dead. I mean, give me a break. This is the 20th century. It was in those days. It's the 20th century. But you know, we're a good family. My parents love my sister and me, and we go to a nice United Church, and we like the songs, and we give to the poor, and we're a happy family. What have you got that we don't have? Dave looked at him, and then he said, watch me. And the student, whose name was also Dave, just to make the story confusing, he said, what do you mean? He said, move in with me. I got an extra bed. Eat my food. Keep my schedule. Go to your classes when you have to. When you're free, you watch me. Till the end of the semester. It's 3 months to the end of the semester. You watch me. You watch how I get up, how I conduct myself, what I talk about, what I think about when I pray. You watch how I relate to other people. You sit in my classes with me. You just watch me. And at the end of 3 months, you tell me there's no difference. Well, the student didn't take him up literally, but he kept going back and going back. By the end of the semester, he was a Christian, and today he's a medical missionary. Because I tell you, Paul has left us an important lesson. Be imitators of me, even as I also am of Christ. Watch me. And that's what Paul is doing here. Look around at the world around you. What do you aspire to? Who's your model? We all follow people. Some athlete? Some gorgeous chick? Or a hunk? Do you just have to have that kind of perfume? Or that kind of dress? Or those kinds of clothing? Or that kind of car? You really would like to be like that actor. And you spend time going through glamour magazines in order to be glamorous. Listen, hold the right mentors in high regard. So now choose your mentor. Whom would you like to emulate? Paul says, follow me. You know all about my teaching. He spent some time reviewing it. You know what I teach about the gospel? How men and women are lost and guilty before God? And God holds them to account, and in judicial wrath stands over against them in eternal threat. But because he's such a loving God, he comes after his own people with grace and self-sacrifice, and in the person of his dear son, bears their guilt, their culpability, their curse himself, demands repentance and faith, and then pours out his spirit upon them so that they will repent and believe. And they do repent and believe, and he gives them the Holy Spirit as the down payment of the promised inheritance, and anticipates a time when there will be a new existence, new resurrection existence, promises it, and shows what it looks like in the person of his dear son who already has resurrection existence. This atoning death has been vindicated by the Father himself as Christ has risen from the dead, and this Christ is already at the Father's right hand, such that all of God's sovereignty is mediated through him. He must reign until he has crushed the last enemy, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death itself. Now he says, you know my teaching. You know my teaching about how this works out in joyful surrender, in sacrifice, in living in the light of eternity, and what it says about marriage, and what it says about relationships, and what it says about missionary work. You know all of this. You know my way of life, my purpose. You know my faith. You know my patience, my love, my endurance. You also know my persecutions. You've watched me in suffering. What kinds of things happened to me in specific concrete places where I've been? How many times I've been beaten up? How many times I've been stoned? The number of times I've been shipwrecked? The number of times I've been beaten to within an inch of my life? You know the times I've been in court? I've got a bigger jail sentence record than most people have. You know that. Follow me. And Paul is not saying this because he thinks he's the supreme guru and he wants a whole lot of little people following along behind and worshiping before him. Yes, master. Yes, master. He's saying this because he says, as he makes explicit elsewhere, be imitators of me, even as I also imitate Christ. For if you follow Paul, insofar as Paul is accurately following Christ, you will find someone who speaks the truth, who incarnates the gospel, who knows how to suffer, who lives for the joy that is set before him, whose whole desire and will is to do the Father's will, who is tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin, and came for sinners. Is it conceivable that we, his followers, will not be interested in sharing that same gospel that others too may know forgiveness of sins? Is that even conceivable? What this suggests is that you who are older, and that's a relative category. It might be 60 when you're dealing with 40-year-olds. It might be 30 when you're dealing with 20-year-olds. It might be fourth year when you're dealing with first years. But you who are older have a certain God-given responsibility to mentor those who are coming along behind. And you who are younger, that's another relative category. That might be 30-year-olds who are looking for senior ministers. It might be 20-year-olds who are looking for those who are a little farther down the pike, maybe a decade or so. It might be first and second years or brand new Christians who are looking at Christians who have been around the track 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 years. You ought to be looking for somebody who will mentor you. Some of you have come out of homes where there never has been a Bible opened in front of you. Do you have any idea how to have family devotions? Find somebody who can teach you. Not just personal devotions, but family devotions with kids and the like. Do you really feel nervous about the possibility of sharing your faith at all? I mean, it really is a bit intimidating, isn't it? We have different personalities. Some are more extrovert than others. I understand all of that. Not everybody has the same degree of capacity to articulate the truth. I know that. But if you have any hunger at all to bear witness to Jesus and talk about the gospel, attach yourself to somebody who does it well. Look for some mentoring. Because there are an awful lot of things in the Christian life that are caught and not just taught. That's why some of the best teaching is not done when there are 1,500 people. That has its place. Jesus could speak to the crowds, thousands at a time. But some of the best teaching is done when you've got 12 or fewer. And you mentor them and talk about life and circumstances and discipline. And you weep and you pray and you share joys and sorrows. That's why small groups that are properly mentored, not just small groups for having a natter, but small groups where there's mentoring going on, are genuinely transformational. It's why in a Christian union group or in a local church, those of you who are in leadership should not be thinking only of what to do in the big meetings, but you should be looking around for particular people with particular gifts who might be taken aside and mentored more closely. If a minister in a church, for example, will only speak at the big meetings, that minister is oblivious to some of the most important opportunities, namely to find those who are most gifted, driven, burdened by the gospel, wanting to learn, taking them aside and giving them more material, giving them more courses, giving them more reading, genuinely discipling them, do you see? As Jesus discipled his 12. Hold on to the right mentors
Hold the right mentors in high regard. Number two, hold few illusions about the world. Hold few illusions about the world. Verses 12 and 13. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and impostors will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. This does not mean that the world itself is always getting worse. What it does mean is that in every generation, bad people, unless they are caught by the gospel, regularly degenerate to become worse. Evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse. Hitler did not start off being Hitler. Well, he had the name, no doubt, but he didn't start off at Auschwitz. And what this text is saying is that this is a time between the first coming and the second coming, this time of the last days, when there will be a conflict between those who live godly lives in Christ Jesus and those, in fact, whose lives are degenerating. They're heading in another direction. They're deceivers and imposters, and they love a certain kind of iniquity. The shape of that iniquity can be hugely diverse. But we should hold few illusions about the world. We should expect some opposition. The astonishing thing is that culture in many parts of the world ignores this most obvious truth, that because we're sinners, we regularly stumble into or drive headlong into more and more violence and more persecution and more corruption and so on. Every time more corruption is exposed, we're all surprised. Imagine this happening. Oh, how shocking. We've just come through the 20th century. Those who keep track of these things tell us that it's the bloodiest century in the history of the human race. Not fewer than 170 million people killed apart from war. So we're not putting in the statistics from World War I, World War II, Korean War, the various tribal conflicts in Africa. We're not putting in the, just killed by governments and by rebellions, local conflicts and this sort of thing. You can run down the various domains where this happened. Perhaps 40 to 50 million Chinese under the communists, about 1 million Hutus and Tutsis, close to 1/3 of the population of Cambodia. You just keep running it down, and it totals up. There are websites that actually track these things. About 170 million human beings killed apart from war in the 20th century. Then you come to the end of the 20th century, and you get a Fukuyama writing a book called The End of History. His thesis was not that history is literally ending. He's saying that history up to that point has been made up of endless conflicts and wars and so on. But now, he was saying, with the demise of the Eastern Bloc, the falling of the wall in Berlin in 1989, the decline of the Russian Empire, well, all the grounds for fundamental conflict are dissolving. There might be some minor squabbles for 2 or 3 more centuries, but we've come to the end of history as we know it. Now we're going to move into a time of democracy and peace, the end of history. When I read the book, it came out in the early 90s, when I read the book, I thought, either Paul is right or Fukuyama is right, but they're not both right. Because history and scripture teach us that there will be evil men and imposters who are worse and worse, deceiving, being deceived, full of hate. There will be wars. Jesus himself says there will be wars and rumors of wars. Don't be dismayed. The end is not yet. Just because there's another war doesn't mean that this is the end time. There will be wars and rumors of wars, and that's not the end time. That's just merely typical. Listen, Christians should always be horrified by evil, but never surprised by it. Because Jesus himself has said that this is the way it will be. My dear friend Tim Keller likes to say, Christians should not be optimists. We know too much about sin. But Christians should not be pessimists, for we know the living God.
Optimism is naive. Pessimism is atheistic. So we live with few illusions of the world. But we serve one who said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And that is the framework in which we live and serve. Third, hold on to the Bible. First, hold the right mentors in high regard. Second, hold few illusions about the world. Third, hold on to the Bible. Verses 14 to 16. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, partly, of course, this is harking back to what Paul has already said in chapter 1. You recall how he reminded Timothy of his own inheritance of sincere faith, which, he says, chapter 1, verse 5, first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice. Now, I am persuaded, lives also in you. Timothy had the advantage, if not of whole families, moms and dads steeped in Scripture. At least on the mom side, there was knowledge of Scripture and a careful passing it on from generation to generation, grandmother to mother. Now he reminds them of that again. As for you, what your obligation is over against the descent of things in the world, what your obligation is to continue in what you have learned and become convinced of that you were taught from infancy. For you know the quality of their lives. From infancy, you have known the Holy Scriptures. And these Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. The reason why we encourage people to read the Bible is not because it is some sort of magic book. There are some people who start feeling guilty if under the pressure of something completely unforeseen, they skip their devotions. Oh, I've got to make it up the next day. If I don't make it up the next day, maybe something bad will happen to me. Maybe my cat will get cancer, or maybe I'll flunk my calculus exam, or my boyfriend will break up with me. I've got to have my devotions. Which is, of course, another form of merit theology. If I can just stroke God with enough compliments and say, yes, Lord, this is your word, and I like it, I like it, I like it, then maybe he'll bless me. But that's not why we read the Bible. We read the Bible in the first place, if we're Christians, because we like it. But in particular, we know that it makes us wise. Wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. We read it aright, and it points us to Jesus Christ in book after book after book, along the trajectories of the Old Testament storylines, all of these patterns that finally bring us to Jesus. Wise for salvation. We think differently. There's a remarkable passage in Deuteronomy 17. It looks to the time when there will be a king in Israel. There wasn't one then, but eventually there would be a king. And there are some special instructions given about what the king is to do when he first comes to his throne. What's he supposed to do? Audit the books of his predecessor? Reorganize the army? Establish his cabinet? No. The text tells us. Deuteronomy 17, 18 to 20. The first thing he's supposed to do is take a copy of this law. Now, whatever this law is, whether it's the whole book of Deuteronomy or some part of it, but it's a big chunk of what we would call the Pentateuch. And he's to copy it out longhand. No downloading it from a CD-ROM onto a hard drive without it going through anybody's brain. No. He's supposed to copy it out longhand in Hebrew so clearly that this becomes his reading copy. And then he's supposed to read it every day for the rest of his life in order that he will not think too highly of himself not superior to his brothers and sister Israelites, and so that he will not turn to the left or to the right, away from God's own instruction. That's what he's supposed to do. If those three verses of the law had been observed in Israel, all of Old Testament history would have been different. When you read Psalm 1 and find a contrast in Psalm 1 between the righteous and the unrighteous, well, the unrighteous, negatively, they listen to the counsel of the ungodly. They adopt the ways of sinners. They sit in the seat of mockers. By contrast, the righteous, they love the law of the Lord and meditate on it day and night. That establishes a whole different pattern. Did you see? They're listening to different advice. They're following a different lifestyle. And Paul understands that this constant rereading of God's Word so fills our minds with God's thoughts that ultimately what we're really imitating is Christ Himself, the Word of God incarnate. We become wise unto salvation by faith in Christ Jesus. And then, unwilling to abandon this theme, he reminds Timothy of what Timothy would have known in any case. It was common understanding amongst Jews and Christians alike. All Scripture is God-breathed. That is, it's not just that the ancient writers, an Isaiah perhaps, or a Moses, or a Zephaniah, or in the New Testament, a Paul, or a John, or a Matthew, it's not that they alone were inspired. The modes that God used to bring about the writing of Scripture were extraordinarily diverse. I don't have time to go through them. But the result, the Scripture itself, is what is God-breathed. By whatever the mode, whether by dictation or in a vision or out of an experience of a psalmist, whatever the mode, the result is so superintended by God's sovereignty, so protected by His Spirit, so governed by His providence that what comes out is God-breathed. You can simultaneously speak of it as the writing of David and the work of the Holy Spirit and God's Word. That sort of thing is done again and again and again. And when you come to this Scripture, this graphe is the word that is used, this Scripture is itself God-breathed. Jesus Himself insists Scripture cannot be broken. And that's why its usefulness is so certain. Because it is God-breathed, it is useful. It's trustworthy. And it's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. This is what generates another community over against the community of the lost. The community of God's people over against the community of evil men and seducers who become worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived in this time between the times, between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ, this time of the last days. This is how Christians are reshaped and reformed by this most holy word. So one of the marks of a church that's beginning to drift, or of a student movement that's beginning to drift, of a campus ministry that's beginning to drift, is where there is a kind of depreciation of God's Word, or where people talk about God's Word in some sort of pious, sentimental sense, but are not actually studying it, or thinking about it, or loving it. God is the one who says, "To this person while I look, he was of a contrite spirit and who trembles at my word." This word is God-breathed. It makes us wise for salvation. It's useful for instruction. That is, it discloses God. God in the past spoke again and again. The word of the Lord came to the prophet Jeremiah saying, and then God speaks through Jeremiah and so on. God disclosed Himself by word. And when the word is re-presented, God is re-revealed. That's what should be going on in our Bible studies. That's what should be going on in a sermon like this one. It's not just instruction in a mere teaching sense, the way you might be instructing people to read Hamlet intelligently, or the way you might be instructing people to understand the next steps in microbiology, or to program computers in the latest language. It's not just instruction like that. There is intellectual content. Of course there is. There is instruction. There is material to be learned. And if you're learning it deeply, then eventually you're going to learn it in the primary languages. Some of you will go and study Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic because those were the languages in which God gave his graphe, his scripture. You want to know God's word. That's right. That's good. But it's more than that. This is the means by which God revealed himself in the past again and again and again and again. He spoke. He's a talking God. And now is that, as that word is represented, God is re-revealed. That's how we encounter God in his word. So this word becomes so useful, therefore, for instruction and for correcting us when we go astray, for rebuking us when we're wicked or rebellious or unbelieving, for bringing encouragement when we are depressed, down in the dumps, unable to see clearly, for bringing enlightenment when we're finding our way so desperately dark, for hearing the promises of God, for seeing Jesus Christ himself in the pages of his word, our imaginations opened up by the apocalyptic imagery of a Revelation 4 and a Revelation 5 until we are hungry and desperately eager to see Christ in all of his glory on the last day. Because this scripture is God-breathed. Useful for all of these things. To what end? So that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. It's a transforming scripture. And finally, hold out the Bible to others. You don't just hold on to the Bible. You hold out the Bible to others. In some ways, in the flow of the argument, verses 1 to 5 here are climactic. Paul puts himself under a huge oath, as it were, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead. I know that, so believe me, I'm speaking the truth now as I address you. In view of his appearing and his kingdom, I will stand before him at the last day. In the light of all of this, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Hold out the Bible to others. That's the heart of all Christian ministry, whether in a Christian union, Christian fellowship group, campus group, or in a local church, cross-cultural ministry. At the end of the day, you re-reveal God by teaching and proclaiming the whole counsel of God. That's at the heart of Christian ministry. Now, of course, there are some that are particularly charged with this sort of responsibility. I know that. So that in the church, in the New Testament, elders, bishops, pastors are particularly charged with this sort of responsibility. And yet there is a sense in which all Christians are charged with this responsibility. When we make disciples, when we're bearing witness, when we're evangelizing, in that sense, we too are involved in teaching the scriptures, aren't we? You don't have to be a pastor to run a local Bible study or to lead a neighbor, a friend, chap down the hall in the dormitory to have a reading session through Mark's gospel or Romans or the like. And then you too are understanding that part of your job as a Christian is not simply to hold on to the Bible, but to hold out the Bible to others. How else is the gospel to advance in this world? With tanks? Send in the Marines? At the end of the day, the gospel makes its way by the power of the Word of God through people's lives, transformed toward righteousness, until at the same time, there is witness born even by the suffering, by the joy that they experience as they anticipate the new heaven and the new earth, by their conformity to Christ, by their love for one another. By this the world shall know that they are Jesus' disciples, if they have love one for another. Not because they're trying harder, but because the gospel has transformed them by the word. And the way a new generation will be transformed is by the word. There have been, in the history of the church, numerous times of revival. Sometimes they are the overspillage of Christians who've been studying the Word for a long time, sometimes in suppressed corners, until the pressure comes off and the gospel explodes again. That's the way it was, as we heard from Femi earlier, in Ethiopia, and it has been like that in other parts of the world too. One of the ways in which revivals themselves quickly go astray has also been charted. One of the ways in which revivals sometimes go astray is when the Lord, through the ministry of the Word, through the truth of the gospel, begins to transform an entire community. There are such spiritual experiences of depth and of transforming power, of a visionary seeing of God, that the experiences themselves become the goal, so that eventually you try preaching the experiences, you try preaching the intensity, you try preaching the testimonies, until finally it's not the gospel anymore, it's not Jesus anymore, it's the experience that is being preached. And then the whole thing rapidly disintegrates and gets destroyed in a kind of orgy of self-focused spirituality. But in one time of genuine reformation and revival that lasted for a period of 60 solid years, sometimes called the Evangelical Awakening, from about 1740 to about 1800, the dominant characteristic was the powerful, unction-filled, anointed preaching of the Word of God by Howell Harris, George Whitfield, John and Charles Wesley, teaching the whole counsel of God, training up new generations of preachers, because they were holding out the Word of God to others. It not only saw hundreds of thousands of people converted, but it transformed the social face of England and of the New England states as well, as prisons were reformed, the slave trade was abolished, child laws were introduced as men and women were transformed by the gospel, so that these things were not the gospel. They were the inevitable results of people who were transformed by the gospel. And the gospel itself was preached and taught. The word of God was held out to others. And when you read stories like that, do you not say to yourself, God, do it again? Do you not? Listen, preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season, not just when it's convenient, not just at the set times. Be eager to give an answer to everybody for the hope that lies within you, Peter says elsewhere. Be prepared. Correct, rebuke, encourage. And make sure you do it with love, with great patience and careful instruction. The time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. You don't have to wait till the 21st century before you find idiotic teachings and heresies and destructive fancies and the like. Check things by the word. Paul already had to confront these things in the first century. But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist. Let me explain that word. When we think of the word evangelist, we either think of somebody like Billy Graham, someone who gives his or her life full-time to evangelism, or child evangelism or the like, or we think of an individual who's particularly gifted in sharing the faith with others. But as far as I can see in the New Testament, that's not what the word means. It includes that, but it's bigger than that. An evangelist is simply one who proclaims the evangel. Doing the work of an evangelist means proclaiming the evangel. That is, being a gospel preacher. And of course, that includes winning people to Christ, but it means teaching the whole counsel of God all the time to all the people of God and to everybody else in order to win as many as you possibly can. Do the work of an evangelist. Teach the word, preach the word, hold out the Bible to others. Discharge all the duties of your ministry, whether in the vocational, semi-professional sense almost, that Timothy has, or that all of us have as Christians, charged with being loyal to Jesus and making disciples until he comes. Hold out the Bible to others. Let us pray. We are ashamed, Lord God, at how easily we're distracted from the central things. How easily we adopt a Pollyannish view of culture. Do not see just how wicked it is in these last days. Do not understand how important it is to get the basics right. How the gospel is passed on from one discipler to a disciplee again and again and again. We are part of that chain. We stand on the shoulders of others, and we begin to see, Lord God, how we want to provide strong shoulders for a generation coming behind us. Give us clear thinking, clear vision, so we will hold no illusions about the world. Grant us such a confidence in your word that we will hold it to our lives dearly, holding on to it, recognizing that it is by this means that you have disclosed yourself again and again in history, not only in great events, not only supremely in the person of your Son, but in the words of this book. And then make us see how important it is to hold this word out to others. Will you not visit us afresh in our generation, Lord God, with converting, convicting, transforming power, so that by this word we see Jesus again and bow in adoration and worship and contrition and renewed confidence in transformed living, holding out the word of God to others. Will you not meet us in our need, Lord God? We beg of you. In Jesus' name, amen.